Dear students, so this is the fifth video lecture, and in this lecture we are going to discuss about case studies of pollution control strategies. So this is one of the topics in unit number 3. So first we should try to understand that what do we mean by the term that is called as a case study. Okay. So most of you might have heard of the term that is called as a case study. So case study is like a statistical representation of a case, right? So we are trying to understand a case with the help of statistics or data. That is called as a case study. So we are going to see the case studies of pollution control strategies. Means we are going to see the statistics of the pollution control strategies that has been adopted in different places. Okay. So what do you mean by a control strategy? So if you just see this term control strategy, so it means that you are going to make a strategy to control pollution at different places, right? So you can either control the pollution at the source itself. And how you can do it? You can do it by two ways, right? First, you can change the process, and second, you can change the raw material itself. Right. Next is what? Next, you can do recycle and reuse. So that will lead to byproduct recovery, so that you can use it again for a different process. And the last one is end of the pipe treatment. It means that you are generating waste in your industry and then you are treating it. So how you are going to treat it? You are going to treat it with the help of primary, secondary and tertiary treatments. Now we are going to discuss about the air quality concerns. So our society has been divided into different areas. So they have been broadly classified as metro cities, okay, or urban areas. Okay, next is the critically polluted areas. And the next one is the rural areas. So first we are going to discuss about the metro or urban areas. Okay, so till now in metro or urban areas, 65 non-attainment cities have been identified. Okay, then what are the dominant sources of pollution? The dominant sources of pollution have been found as vehicular emission, small medium scale industries, then biomass burning. So these are the particular sources of pollution in this 65 non-attainment source, 65 non-attainment cities. Then it has been identified that in these metro places, the major pollutants are actually NOx, then solid particulate matter and carbon monoxide. Next is the critically polluted areas. Critically polluted areas means these are heavily polluted. Right, so till now 24 critically polluted areas have been identified. Then the dominant sources of pollution are industries, power plants, refineries, chemical plants, etc. The major pollutants, that is air pollutants, which are found are NOx, solid particulate matter, then SO2, volatile organic compounds, okay, and PAH. Right, so pH is a volatile organic compound, right, that mixes with the air and pollutes it. Next is rural area. Okay, so rural area, it affects our air the least, right? So it is the least major concern for our air quality, right? So what are the sources of air pollution in this rural area? The use of biomass, coal and kerosene, it causes pollution. What are the outdoor air pollutants? So normally unpaved road, right? So normally if you go to a rural area, you won't get a paved road. So paved road means the road which is made up of tar. So normally you will get muddy roads, right? And this muddy roads can lead to pollution. Why? Because it is made up of sand, right? And when this sand mixes with the air, it will lead to solid particulate matter, right? Next is the biomass money. So I think everybody knows that how villagers are dependent upon the biomass. So normally they used to burn the coal, they used to burn the leaves, right, and they used to burn the wood to derive the energy which is used for cooking and different household purposes, right? So biomass burning also adds up to the pollution. So what are the major pollutants which are found in the rural area? So the major pollutants are solid particulate matter, okay, and carbon monoxide. Now we are going to discuss about the institutional mechanism. Okay, so there are different institutions which have been made at the central and state level to enforce control strategies So institutional mechanism has been set up at the central and state level to control pollution and to make different control strategies. Okay, so at the central level there are different ministries and there are different boards which have been formulated, right? So first is Ministry of Environment and Forest. Second is Central Pollution Control Board. Third is Environmental Pollution Control Authority. Fourth is Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. Fifth is Ministry of Road Transport and Highways. And then there are other ministries and R&D center, that is Research and Development Centers. At the state level, what are the different boards and different ministries? So Department of Environmental Pollution, then it is called as Control Board or Committees, and then there are some local bodies in the different villages, right? So these are the institutions, so these are the ministries, these are the centers, these are the institutions which are having the power to make control strategies to control pollution, right? Now we are going to discuss about the emission in metropolitan cities, right? So first we are going to talk about the air pollution from vehicles in the state of Delhi. So Delhi is a union territory. Okay, so we are going to discuss about the air pollution from vehicles. Okay, so if you could see in the x-axis, these are the different air pollutants, right? So this one is carbon monoxide, then hydrocarbon, then NOx, then particulate matter, then comes the NOx, next is the particulate matter, then benzene, okay, and then butadiene. Okay, so these are the different air pollutants in the Delhi, the state of Delhi. But if you see the proportion of carbon monoxide which is adding to the pollution is way higher as compared to the other pollutants, right? So carbon monoxide is one of the major air pollutant in the state of Delhi. Okay, so similarly, if we see air pollution from vehicles in the city of Mumbai, so again carbon monoxide, hydrocarbons, NOx, solid particulate matter, benzene and butadiene have been found as the major air pollutants, but the proportion of carbon monoxide is the the proportion of carbon monoxide is the highest as compared to other air pollutants. Okay, so these are the other air pollutants, and if you compare all this, okay, if you compare all of this as compared to carbon monoxide, carbon monoxide contribution to the air pollution, that is vehicular air pollution in Mumbai, is the greatest. Now we are going to discuss about the different control strategies which have been adopted, okay, in our country. So air quality standards have been notified and air pollution control areas have been declared. Next is emission standards notified for industry vehicles. Then fuel quality improvement has been suggested. So instead of using pure gasoline, you can blend it with a biofuel and thus you can improve the quality of the fuel. Next is relocation of the polluting industries from the urban areas, okay, to the outskirts. Next is roadmap for the control of emission from new and in-use vehicles developed up to the year 2010. And the last but very important, use of alternate fuels. Okay, so use of alternate fuels like CNG, LPG, ethanol, petrol, biodiesel and hydrogen is also one of the major control strategies adopted for improving the quality of air. Next, corporate response. So CREP has been developed. So next control strategy is CREP. I think you don't know about this. So CREP stands for Corporate Responsibility for Environmental Protection. So it has been developed for 17 category of industry in our country. So specific control strategy has been adopted for different industries. Initiative has been also taken for small scale sector or cottage industries. Then city specific air quality monitoring action plan has been also taken by the different ministries and different institutions. So there are some industrial specific control strategy. Okay, so there are some industry specific control strategy. So if we take example of a thermal power plant, what are the control strategy at a thermal power plant? Okay, so first is ash utilization time frame laid down. Okay, so how to first one is how to utilize the ash which has been generated in a thermal power plant, because normally if you go to a thermal power plant, lot of coal is used as a fossil fuel, right? So coal is actually used to fire the burners, and once the coal is actually burnt, they produce ash, right? So more and more ash could be used for different purposes. That is point number one. Next is enforcement of PM emission standards. Okay, so it has been checked that whether the thermal power plant industries, okay, are actually adhering to the PM emission standard or not. Then it has been found that 70% compliance has been found. Okay, next is mandatory use of beneficiated coal. Okay, beneficiated coal means it is a good quality coal. So if an industry uses a good quality coal, it is again going to reduce air pollution. Next is promotion of clean coal technologies. Okay, so you have to use clean coal technology. So one of the prime example is fluid bed catalytic cracking. Okay, so FBC stands for fluid bed catalytic cracking. So it is one of the clean coal technologies. And next is tall stack dispersion. Okay, so normally if you go to a thermal power plant, you could see a couple of chimneys over there. So it has been one of the control strategies in this thermal power plant is the usage of tall stack. So the height of the chimney should be large enough, right? So that it can disperse the pollutant far into the atmosphere, so that the people living at the ground, they should be least affected. Next is, what are the control strategies and policies adopted for oil refineries? Okay, so next, so in oil refineries, control of sulfur dioxide emissions has been done by using high efficiency sulfur recovery unit. SRU stands for sulfur recovery unit, adequate stack height, and low sulfur. Adequate stack height and low sulfur fuels. So Mathura refinery emission. So in Mathura refinery, it is an IOCL plant, that is Indian Oil Corporation Limited plant. So there it has been seen that emissions have been restricted to 10.8 metric tons per day. Okay, so total SO2 emission was 175 metric ton per day. Okay, so this total SO2 emission has been reduced from 175 metric ton per day to 123 mmtpa capacity. Next is SO2 emission standard being revised and NOx and VOC standard to be introduced, and the leak detection and repair program to reduce the fugitive emissions. Okay, so people are going to check, so all the people who are maintaining the different units in a oil refinery, they are going to see that whether there is any leak or not present in a certain equipment, and then they should do proper maintenance of those equipment just to reduce the miscellaneous emissions. Next is, what are the initiatives that have been taken to control air pollution from industrial sector? So in the brick kiln sector, okay, so brick kiln sector is one of the major sector. So normally we use brick kiln in the real estate quite extensively. Okay, so first control strategy is replacement of movable chimney by a fixed chimney, and this will save the coal by 10%. So you can use 10% lesser coal if you replace movable chimney by a fixed chimney. Next is better firing and feeding practices. So again, this can save the usage of coal by almost 10%. And the last one is the usage of vertical shaft brick kiln, which can again save the usage of coal by 10 to 16%, right? So these are the control strategies which have been suggested for a brick kiln industry. Next, we are going to discuss about the different steps that have been taken to improve air quality in Delhi and NCR region. So industrial pollution control strategies which have been taken in Delhi and NCR region is the usage of beneficiated coal or good variety coal having ash content of only 34%. So this, the usage of this beneficiated coal has been made mandatory in thermal power plant in areas around Delhi. Next, it has been ordered to close the hazardous air polluting industries. Next is shifting of high polluting industries from non-conforming areas to conforming areas. Next is emission standards for DG sets. Next is notification and approved fuel for Union Territory of Delhi. Then upgradation of ESPs in 3 coal-based power stations in Delhi. The next one is use of LDO instead of coal in small boilers. Now, approved fuel for Union Territory of Delhi. Okay, so these are the approved fuel as per the control strategy adopted. So first is diesel, next is LPG and CNG. So if you could have observed, more and more number of CNG vehicles, specifically the autos that are being run in the Union Territory of Delhi, is extensively used. Next is kerosene, then naphtha for power plants, aviation turbine fuel for aircrafts. Okay, and firewood has to be used only in the rural areas and in the crematory purposes. And next is biogas, right? So these are the approved fuel for the Union Territory of Delhi. So now we are going to see the case studies or statistics for the air pollutants in the Union Territory of Delhi. Okay, so if you could see this graph, in the x-axis you could see the years. So these are the years, okay, and these are the levels. So this is the level of air pollution in the y-axis. Okay, so if you could see the sulfur dioxide, so this actually, this graph basically discusses about the SO2 level in the ambient air. So there are 4 sources, that is residential, industrial, traffic intersection and vehicle population. Okay, if you could see that from year 97 to year 2003, the residential sector, the contribution of SO2 from residential sector has been reduced. Okay, so you could see that it has been reduced. Okay, On opposite, the contribution of SO2 from the vehicular population, the contribution from vehicle population has been increased, okay, and this increase is actually very much linear and very much significant. So vehicular population leads to an increase in the SO2 level, and residential sector has led to a decrease in the SO2 level from year 97-98 to 2003-2004. Okay, similarly, industrial and traffic intersection also leads to a decrease in the level of SO2. Okay, so the level of SO2 in these two sectors, industrial, traffic intersection and residential, has been reduced, but it has been increased for vehicular population. Next, we are going to see that how the proportion of suspended particulate matter in ambient air comes from the different industries. So if you see this graph from the residential sector, so the yellow points resembles the residential contribution. So from residential contribution, it is the least. Okay, so least number of residences contribute to the SPM, okay, which is followed by the industry, okay, and then it is followed by the vehicular population, okay. So if you see from 97 to 98, the proportion of SPM, which is coming from traffic intersection and vehicular population, is increasing linearly, right? So it means that there is a increase in the SPM coming from traffic intersection and vehicle population. Again, the same thing here is for now oxides of nitrogen, that is NOx. So here you could see that the proportion of NOx coming from residential sector and industrial sector is lesser as compared to coming from traffic intersection and vehicular population. Although this number is actually increasing from the year 97 to 98 from all the sources, but the increase is significant for traffic intersection and vehicular population. Now we are going to discuss about one of the case study of a chemical lime company in Canada, okay, which produces lime. Next is hydrated lime and the crushed limestone. So these three products it basically produces. So what were the major goals of this industry? The major goal of this industry was to improve the operational efficiency, to reduce the material wastage, to reduce fugitive dust emissions, use heat released from lime cooling operations to fuel efficiency. What were the achievements? The achievements were fines discharge reduced by 50-70%, spillage of quicklime reduced by around 2 tons per shift, process water recycling and runoff water utilization reduces sewer systems, and the fines emissions, which has been reduced by 50-70%, and there was a considerable reduction in the dust losses by leaks in the equipments of the industry.